Good morning. Our call to worship is Psalm 119, verses 105 and 133.
Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light for my path. Direct my footsteps according to your word. Let no sin rule over me. Amen.
Ask you to stand as you are able, and we will sing number 571, the five verses, Trust and Obey. Anybody 15 minutes ago, but it's nice to see that everybody has arrived, and I trust as we serve our Lord and Savior, we will all be blessed. In way of announcements, I know it is somebody's birthday today. We won't mention Elsie by name. Doug has a birthday in a week and a half. Herb Perry has a birthday this Thursday. Any other August birthdays? Shirley has a birthday. Marilyn has a birthday. Wonderful. I forgot to do this 2 weeks ago, so we will sing Happy Birthday.
Happy birthday to you. May the Lord bless and keep you. Happy birthday to you.
I was hoping somebody was going to do that. I don't have any other announcements to really make, so I will at this time lead you in the prayer of invocation. Shall we go to our Lord in prayer? Father, we come into this your house to worship and praise you, for you lighting our pathway, for directing our feet again this morning as we open and study your word. The word that you have given us, the word that we look at every week, but we sometimes just take for granted. We acknowledge we don't always trust and obey. We have doubts, fears, and joys as we walk down life's road. Help each of us to walk closely with you towards eternal glory. Father, as we bow in prayer, listen to and unburden us as you carry our concerns. We know you rejoice in our commitment to follow our Lord Jesus. Once again, we thank you for the songs that you have given us. The words are an encouragement and bring joy and contentment. Father, I thank you for each person here this morning. Bless each of us as we hear your voice calling us to walk hand in hand with you, as we will hear in today's message. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You'll hear a lot about walking today, so that word's going to come up a whole bunch. This time I invite you to stand once again. We're going to sing number 607, Close to Thee, 607. Responsive reading at this time. Blessed are those whose ways are blameless. Blessed are those who keep his statutes. They do no wrong. You have laid down precepts that are to be fully obeyed.
Oh, how my ways were steadfast in obeying your precepts.
Then I would not be put to shame.
When I consider all your commandments.
I will praise you with an upright heart as I learn your righteous laws.
I will obey your decrees to my brothers who
save me. Amen. This time I'll ask the ushers to take up their offering. Shall we pray? Father God, we love you, we adore you, we praise you, and that is why we are here this morning. Lord, we ask that you take this offering, that you accept it from the hands that have given it. Bless those hands. Bless the money to the working of your church, and bless each and every one of us as we continue to serve you. In Jesus' name, amen. Once again, you get to sing. You get to sing the children's hymn, even though there's no children here. So we'll expect you to sound like children and sing out really light, nice and loud as we sing number 184, Thy Word. This time I invite you to give me wonderful praise items for this past week. James.
I praise the Lord for every time I open the Bible. He reveals something to me. And this week, I was in Romans 3, and it talks about God's righteousness. And when you hear so many people saying, how could he be a loving God when this happens or that happens? God has allowed us all to make our own choices and decisions. He didn't do it, but he made a way out of it. So Romans 3 just reveals to us that God is a righteous God and we are made righteous in him.
Anyone else? Any prayer requests? I want to, at this point, sorry, I forgot. As you may or may not know, Shirley is going for surgery on Wednesday. So I ask you to keep Shirley in your prayers this week, that the doctors may solve all of Shirley's problems and she will have a bigger smile than she normally had. Right, Shirley? Yes, Jen.
Am I the only one talking here?
Yep. Oh, I talk every now and then, too.
Now, the thing is, everyone here needs something from the Lord. So I just pray and ask the Lord that he would hear the heart's requests of everyone here and answer their prayer requests and journey mercies for all our brothers and sisters that are on the road.
Anyone else? Elsie. I can't hear you, I'm sorry.
My daughter Susan is going for a biopsy on Monday.
Grace.
I think you should pray for Shelly and neighbor years down the road. Let's go for treatment next week.
Is it Kelly, did you say?
Shelly.
Oh, Shelly, okay. I may have to get hearing aid yet. Anybody else? Let's go to our Lord in prayer. Father God, you are our almighty Lord, our King eternal. We come thanking and praising you, for you are worthy of all our praise. We come to worship and bow down before your holy throne of grace. What a wonderful world you created. Open our eyes to see your beauty displayed all around us. Do not let sin and Satan keep us from fully acknowledging your goodness and love. Yes, Father, we too have fallen short of living a life pleasing to you. Wipe our slates clean. Clear our minds to hear and follow you. What a privilege it is to pray to you, knowing without a doubt that you listen to and continue to give us our daily needs. We live in a broken world where people do unspeakable things. Our hearts go out to those in need of comfort from mass shootings. Our hearts go out to those who are in need of comfort for atrocities that are committed against them. Our heart goes out to those who need help from oppressive governments, for refugees, for our neighbors who do not make you Lord of their lives, for the person sitting beside us who has fears and doubts that we don't know about. But you, O Lord, still bless us with rain and sunshine and flowers and trees, with untold joys and pleasures. For this we thank you once again. Father, we thank you that Herb can celebrate another birthday this week. We ask that you continue to be with him and Gladys in Canada. And Lord, we thank you for the Bible. We thank you for your word. And Lord, we can open the Bible anywhere and find a message that will speak to our hearts if we read it with you in mind. Father, this morning we pray for those among us who are in need of or receiving medical care. Guide the doctor's hands on Wednesday during Shirley's surgery. Bring her back to full health, we pray. Encourage those recuperating from treatments. Surround those who are mourning the loss of loved ones. Be close to all our dear members in retirement and nursing homes. You know each of them, and enfold them with your peace and contentment. Be with those who are traveling and visiting this time of year. And Father, we ask that you be with Susan and her biopsy. We ask that you be with Shelley. And Lord, there are so many needs that we don't hear about, but you know each and every one of them. Father, we ask you to bless this service. Guide me as I speak. Help each of us to hear your inner gentle voice as we continue to walk the road that you have laid before us, holding on to the glorious message you found in your word as we receive them week after week, but also in our daily devotions and time of prayer. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning is from Micah. Micah chapter 6, verses 6 through 8, where it says the following: With what shall I come before the Lord and bow down before the exalted God? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I offer my firstborn for my transgressions, the fruit of my body, for the sin of my soul? The next verse, verse 8, is our text for today. He has made it clear to you, mortal man, what is good and what the Lord is requiring from you: to act with justice, to treasure the Lord's gracious love, and to walk humbly in the company of your God. The Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word. Do you walk humbly in the company of your God? Or do you walk alone by yourself? Walking with God is tough. I mean, when you walk with somebody, they're right beside you. They see everything that you see. They hear everything that you hear. They have to step over curves, around snowbanks, around puddles. And when you walk with somebody, you talk, you listen. You get to know them. You get to know their heart. You get to know what they're thinking. And it's the same when you walk with God. You get to know God's heart. You get to learn how to serve and love him better. The thing is that when you walk with the Lord, one thing is most certain, and that is that you have to align your will with his. Walking with God does not mean spending a little time in prayer each week. Walking in God is a lifestyle that we can only obtain through Jesus Christ our Lord. It's a lifelong journey. Picture you're going on a trip with a friend. Your friend doesn't like your pet alligator. So, because you like your friend more than your pet alligator, you leave your pet alligator at home. It's the same when you're walking with God. God doesn't like your sin, so you can't bring it along. Or you can't bring along all the baggage that will keep you from fully committing to him. When you walk with God, you choose to imitate him, and through that you glorify him in every way. Let's look and see if we can figure some of this out this morning. In Amos 3, verse 3, the prophet Amos revealed an important truth about what it means to walk with God when he asks, "Can two walk together unless they agree?" The word he used for together gives the idea of two people moving in rhythm with each other. It's like riding a tandem bicycle. You go in tandem, you go in sequence with each other. But it's not about getting into God's rhythm, it's about you getting into rhythm with God. And that means God gets the front seat on the bicycle and you follow behind. That means putting him at the forefront of your whole life. So back to the question, do you walk with God or do you stroll along life's road, wandering this way and that all week, bumping into God every now and then when you say a prayer or two, if you remember? And oh yes, on Sundays I go to church, so therefore I'm a Christian, right? I'm sure there are times in your life when you feel great joy, passion and even excitement about being a Christian. And there are times when you just don't feel it. But that doesn't mean you say, well, that's it. I don't get any joy out of being a Christian and all that stuff. I'm going to go and do my own thing. I'm not going to follow Jesus anymore. I don't see the point in it all. Why go to church at all? I'd like to read you an email I received a few months ago. It goes as follows. It says, if you're spiritually alive, you're going to love this. If you're spiritually dead, you don't want to hear it. If you're spiritually curious, there's still hope for you. A churchgoer wrote a letter to the editor of a newspaper and complained that it made no sense to go to church every Sunday. He wrote, I have gone to church for 30 years now. In that time, I have heard some 3,000 sermons, but for the life of me, I can't remember a single one of them. So I think I'm wasting my time by going to church, and the preachers and priests are wasting theirs by giving sermons at all. It started a real controversy in the letters to the editor. Much to the delight of the editor, it went on for weeks until someone wrote this clincher. I have been married for 30 years now. In that time, my wife has cooked me some 32,000 meals. But for the life of me, I can't recall the entire menu for a single one of those meals. But I do know this. They all nourished me and gave me strength, the strength I needed to do my work. If my wife hadn't given me these meals, I would be physically dead today. Likewise, if I had not gone to church for nourishment, I would be spiritually dead today. I thank God for our physical and spiritual nourishment. That's the end of the email. Romans 1 verse 17 says, it does not say, the just shall live by feelings. It says, the just shall live by faith. Feelings change. Walking with God takes faith. It takes commitment. It takes consistency. A good definition of faith is, faith sees the invisible, believes the incredible, receives the impossible. Let me go through that again. Faith sees the invisible, our God and Father, believes the incredible, that Jesus died for our sins, receives the impossible, the Holy Spirit, and eternal life with God. Back to walking. Do you walk in such a way that your happy God is walking beside you? He hears everything you say, sees everything you do. Nothing is hidden, no secrets, not even your thoughts. Sin sort of puts a kink in that walk. Let's look at Genesis 3, verse 8. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man, where are you? Is God calling you, saying, where are you? Did you notice who initiated the action? It was God. He comes looking for them. And what were they doing? They were hiding. Are you hiding? Let's face it. We know God sees and hears everything we do and say. I know I'm not very comfortable with that. Sometimes the things I say and do are not what I think God should hear. Sometimes my mouth is in gear before my brain engages. Sometimes anger takes over before the thinking starts. But things, once out of the mouth, cannot be taken back. Let's look for an example from the Bible about walking with God. The Bible tells us about a man who walked with God for many years. His name was Enoch. There are some secrets from his life that we can apply to our lives as well. In the whole of the Bible, there are only 5 times that refer to Enoch. 2 of them are in genealogies. Although we don't find a lot written about Enoch, what we do have is significant. Genesis 5, 21-24 tells us, Enoch lived 65 years and begot Methuselah. After he begot Methuselah, Enoch walked with God 300 years, met sons and daughters. So all the days of Enoch were 365 years. Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. Can you imagine that? God just took him. He didn't have to get sick. He didn't have to get old. He didn't have to die. He had a one-way ticket straight to heaven. It must have been absolutely marvelous for him. But what did he do? He walked with God. Enoch lived during a very unique time in history, just before God's judgment on the world with the flood. Against a very dark backdrop was a man who walked with God, who was spared death. Enoch is a prototype of the last day believers, showing us how to live by walking with God as we await the Lord's return. So what set Enoch apart? How was he able to live a godly life in such an ungodly world, a time that was characterized by sexual perversion and uncontrolled violence? What was so special about Enoch? Four little words. He walked with God. The analogy of walking and the Christian life is used throughout Scripture. I hope whenever you read a passage that mentions walking, in some of what I say today will come to mind. It is not merely living it by church rules and man-made regulations or making daily resolutions that we quickly break. It is much more than that. Hebrews 11, verse 5 says this about Enoch. He had this testimony that he pleased God. Sometimes we have the mistaken idea that God is very hard to please. Yet God loves us. He loves us even though he knows when and where we goof up, what mistakes we made. He knows us better than we know ourselves. And you know what? He still loves you. He still loves me. He's not that as hard to please as we may think. How do we please God? God is pleased when, in spite of the fact that we are in the right, we patiently endure when misunderstood. 1 Peter 2, verses 19 and 20 says, "For it is commendable if somebody bears up under the pain of unjust suffering just because they are conscious of God. But how is it to your credit if you receive a beating for doing wrong and endure it? But if you suffer for doing good and you endure it, this is commendable before God." When you do what is right, when you follow God, when you profess God as your Lord and Savior, when people look at you and think there's something wrong with you because you do that, that is pleasing God. And that is something we should do whenever we have the opportunity. So Enoch walked with God. God was pleased with him. And lastly, he had a testimony and was a witness. Each and every one of us have a testimony. And each and every one of us are a witness. People are watching you and watching me. They're looking to see if we are walking the walk or just talking the talk. We should give a lot of thought to that. Before we can effectively witness for God, we must first walk with him. Enoch walked with God and saw the world for what it was, a stopgap before heavenly glory. Imagine walking in with someone who is at total peace. Total serenity. No need to talk. Just enjoy each other's company. That's walking with God. Sometimes the noises of our lives, our many activities, our hectic schedules, our high-tech devices, our other distractions drowned out the voice of God. Sometimes it seems like God is far away or not there at all. But joy only comes when our lives are centered in Christ. Satan worked very hard to keep joy away by filling our lives with noise. To hear the voice of God reminding us of his faithfulness, goodness, and love, we need to follow the instructions of Psalm 46, verse 10, which I know each and every one of you know. It says, "Be still and know that I am God. Take time every day to silence the noise, to be still, listening for God's whisper. Can you do that? Can you take your mind from the hustle and bustle of the things going on around you and stop it? Make it go still. Listen, and then feel the love of God that will fill you. Yes, it will fill you in such a way that it will overflow, and then you can feel Him walking with you in peace. It probably will not happen the first time you try to do it. May not happen a second. But be tenacious. Don't give up. It's a wonderful feeling. It's wonderful because the Holy Spirit fills you. He fills you, and He prompts you. He lifts your spirit. He shows you how to solve problems. He shows you how He shows you answered prayer. He comforts you in time of grief. He shows you ways out of trouble. Just trust and obey, as we sang earlier. I'm sure most of you have heard the poem, Footprints in the Sand. But I think it bears repeating because I think it fits very well with what we're talking about this morning. I would like to read it to you. One night a man had a dream. He dreamed that he was walking along the beach with the Lord. Across the sky flashed scenes from his life. For each scene, he noticed two sets of footprints in the sand, one belonging to him and the other to the Lord. When the last scenes of his life flashed before him, he looked back at the footprints in the sand. He noticed that many times along the path of his life, there was only one set of footprints. He also noticed that this happened at the very lowest and saddest times in his life. This really bothered him, and he questioned the Lord about it. Lord, he said, Lord, you said that once I decided to follow you, you would walk with me all the way. But I have noticed that during the most troublesome times in my life, there is only one set of footprints. I don't understand why when I needed you most, you would leave me. The Lord replied, my son, my precious child, I love you and I would never leave you. During the times of trials and suffering, when you see only one set of footprints, that is when I carried you. Isn't it great to know that when we walk with God, He will carry us through the rough patches? I know looking back at my life, I have been carried many times, even when I didn't realize it. But sometimes, like a two-year-old, I was dragged along, kicking and complaining that things just aren't fair. And there are sometimes a total peace, just being carried along. When God is walking beside you, things look different. Trees and flowers take on a wondrous look, like it says in Luke 12, verse 27. Consider how the wildflowers grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you, not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. For those of us who did the Bible study on God of Wonders, it opened our eyes to the beauty yet intricate ways we and all of creation were made, and how it still continues. Walking with God enhances all of our senses by helping us to praise Him more, to sing of His might, and to glorify Him in all that we do. Is it possible to do this 24/7? Not for me. Sin keeps getting in the way. Satan finds little cracks in us and slowly opens them up to draw us away from walking with God. Worry is one big sin that keeps me from walking in faith and trusting God. The world is filled with situations that can make us feel depressed. But there are better options. Look at what you have. Your hurts, pains, and problems can draw a lot out of you. But God through Christ gives you more. Catalog, write down His kindnesses and goodness. Everything from sunsets to the beauty of flowers, and yes, even the beauty of weeds. But most of all, salvation. Oh, the wonder of salvation, the forgiveness of our sins. Look with new eyes at what you have and what you have been given. Let Jesus be the friend that you need. Walk with him side by side. Talk to him. Spare no details. Disclose your fears. Describe your joys and dreads. Will your hurts disappear? Who knows? In a sense, does it really matter? You have a friend for life. And what could be better than the sure knowledge that God's Son is walking with you? That is treasuring the Lord's gracious love. Look at what our text says. What is good and what the Lord is requiring from you to act with justice, to treasure the Lord's gracious love, and to walk humbly in the company of our God, of your God. The good news is that if you want peace, if you want to please God, you have to honestly walk with God. You have to walk humbly. It's hard for me to walk humbly. Humility is not a part of my natural nature. I must walk humbly day in and day out in all situations. Walk humbly in the company of my God, not alone, but with God helping me. I have to remind myself of this every morning when I wake up, that it's not about me. It's all about him. Here's a question I would like you to ask yourself. Are you a thermometer or a thermostat? A thermometer is affected by its surroundings. It depends on the temperature, it goes up and down. In contrast, a thermostat affects its surroundings. Unlike a thermometer, it controls the environment around it. You merely react to what is happening around you. Or do you have some kind of impact on it? Are you changing culture? Or is culture changing you? In other words, do you walk with God or do you merely float along, acquiescing to what is going on in the world around you? We all need to become what God intended us to be. Thermostats, warming the surroundings, drawing folks into a loving embrace of God so that they can start or continue walking with him. How do we improve our walk with God? Spend time in prayer. And after that, spend time in prayer. Is there a proper and right way to pray? Yes, there is. In our Bible study on prayer and how to pray, it states and restates, if you're praying, you're already doing it right. So just do it more. There's no wrong way to talk to God. You can be angry. You can be happy. You can tell him you think you've been given a raw deal in life. Just talk to him. I know our study on prayer has changed my attitude. I was very angry with God for taking my wife home. But I have found out it's okay to be angry with God. He understands. And he has given me a whole lot of healing in the last year through that Bible study. Talk to him. Pray for everything and everybody. Nothing is too big or too trivial for God. No one is out of his sight and beyond his reach. He wants everyone to come to him and profess Jesus as the Lord and Savior. And your prayer for that person might just be the tipping point of commitment in his or her life. Find one or two daily devotion books or online devotions. Daily meditate on the message. Come to church and don't just fill the pew. Listen intently to the message. Look at the words in the songs we sing. Pray earnestly to God to show you through the help of the Holy Spirit how to bless someone each and every day because of the blessing you have received from walking with God. Listen to his gentle voice of encouragement guiding you. Is walking with God something that really happens? You bet it does. And it can for you. It's so easy to sit back and be busy with life. God is waiting for you and me every time we seek him. Heaven's door is always open. They are always waiting, listening, longing for you to knock on that door. In this "it's all about me" generation, it's not hard to notice a man or a woman of God, You can tell by their mannerisms, by their speech, by how they live their lives, that they love God and they are part of His select family. In closing, I would like to give you two quotes. The first one from Henry Ford. We all know what Henry Ford did for a living. He built cars to get us to our destinations. But Henry Ford said, "Those who walk with God always reach their destination." The second is from Dwight L. Moody. "If I walk with the world, I cannot walk with God." I'd like to leave you with Psalm 16, where it says, "As our eyes look for satisfaction out there, to gaze instead on God's beauty, we find ourselves finally tasting true contentment, a life of basking in the joy of God's love, presence, walking with Him each moment in the way of life, now and forever. It is my prayer that you set aside time each day to walk with God. The more you do it, the more it will take over your life. The more peace and quiet that will fill your soul, and you will be blessed and be a blessing to others in so many ways. Be still and know that He is God as you walk humbly with Him, minute by minute, day by day." Let us go to Him in prayer. Father God, we ask you to hold our hand, guide our feet as we walk with you today and in the weeks and months ahead. Open doors. Give us opportunity to tell others of the joy and the peace that can only be found in your loving embrace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you walk with Jesus, you have to sing this song because it says, "I have decided to follow Jesus." Ask you to stand as soon as you are able. Of the invisible God the Father be the light by which you walk. By faith, let the incredible compassion of Jesus the Son be the love by which you walk. By faith, accept the presence of the Holy Spirit, who will be the power by which you walk. Amen.